Your Steve Jones Show podcast is loading now. The Steve Jones Show podcast is sponsored by Purdy Insurance. Visit Purdy Insurance on Market Street in Sunbury or visit online at purdyinsurance.com. Sports talk where your voice counts. This is the Steve Jones Show on News Radio 1070 WKOK. Now, from the Sunbury Motors Studio, here's Steve Jones.
Sunbury Motors, 4th Street in Sunbury. Sunbury Motors, Key Routes 11 and 15 in Hummel's Wharf. And you go to sunburymotors.com. Check out their great inventory. Ford, Lincoln, Hyundai, Kia, pre-owned inventory. Check it out online at sunburymotors.com. And then you can buy from the comfort of your own home. And today's show brought to you by Purdy Insurance. Market Street in Sunbury. Go to purdyinsurance.com. Purdy's have been able to take care of this valley insurance-wise for decades. Auto, home, life, business, bundles, whatever it may be. And in any case where it's possible, they find you the best price. And they'll update, they'll take good care of that policy. And if there's ever a case where you need to use your insurance, and that's why you have it, in case you need it, they will go to work as if it happened to them. Customer service means everything to the great people at Purdy Insurance, Market Street in Sunbury. But in these times, always remember you can go to purdyinsurance.com. I believe we're going to be hearing from the governor at the bottom of the hour.
That is correct. He and Secretary of State Kathy Boockvar are addressing the media at 3:30 today to discuss mail-in ballots and how to apply for that, how to conduct it for the June 2nd primary, and there'll be other updates associated with that, too.
And that'll be coming up at the bottom of the hour. Then we have Mike Gross on today. It'd be great to have Mike on. I've never had Mike on the show before. We are going to, we're really looking forward to having him on. He's a great guy, does great work. And we're looking forward to that. All right. Let's see. I don't think there's really any updates coronavirus-wise. I mean, there's three more new ones here in Center County, which is now at 105. Unfortunately, one has passed away, and that was a few weeks ago, an 89-year-old. Here, what about your area? What about the valley?
Northumberland reached 100 cases total today for the county. Montour, that was the only one we had today. Montour still at 50, Union still at 38, and Snyder still at 33 with one death.
Yeah, okay. So that's where we stand right now.
And we had a couple nursing home issues pop up in Northumberland and Union counties, but nothing major.
Yeah, that's actually been in part the issue here. The number of increases here, I think a couple have been in nursing homes, and I think a couple at one of the prisons. There are multiple prisons here in Center County. It's not just Rockview. There's Benner. There's Center County. I think that's actually cropped up. More than anything else. State College has actually remained relatively stable. Of the 105, 36 were in State College. It's actually been a greater increase, and I think this is where I'm wondering about either between the prison population or nursing home. Most of them have been in Bellefonte, Milesburg, Pleasant Gap. The NFL is going to release its schedule, and speaking of the NFL, Don Shula passed away today at the age of 90. Shula is the winningest coach in the history of the NFL. I think he broke the record against the Eagles, didn't he, Matt? Yeah. No? Yeah, he did. I know he did, as a matter of fact. Just thought I'd get that in there for you, because I know you get excited about any time we talk about the Eagles.
I always appreciate it.
I think it's important that the Eagles played a role in history. All right, so...
And actually, do you know who the quarterback was for the Dolphins in that game, right?
In that game?
And at the vet when he got 325 career wins?
Yeah. This is... Doug Peterson.
That is correct.
Yeah.
And he's even said... That is the second most significant win he's ever had, other than just right below Super Bowl 52.
Well, what's interesting is the Shula, I guess, had a pretty good sense of humor. So they had a big birthday get together for him in January. He turned 90. So a lot of former players, former Dolphins, came back to be with him. And he looked around the room and he said, "Where were all you people when I turned 89 last year?" All right. Shula had an interesting career. He won, do you realize that he only had two losing seasons between 1963 and 1995? He had two losing seasons. That was it. He had, like, I want to say four 500 seasons, but he only had two losing seasons ever in his career. Remarkable. But he is, and this happens so often. And we just, for example, for those of you watching the Jordan documentary, well, in the Jordan documentary, what does Jordan have to overcome? He has to overcome the image that on the pro level, he can't win the big one. Yeah, the Celtics knock him out. Then they face the Pistons. The Pistons keep beating them. They had to get over that hurdle. Can't win the big one. What was LeBron James, the knock on him? Can't win the big one. You go back to the 70s. Let's go back to the late 60s to the early 70s. Cowboys, can't win the big one. 60s into the 70s, into the mid-70s. What can't the Raiders do? Can't win the big one. Well, Don Shula, believe it or not, was in that same category. In his second year as an NFL head coach, he's got Johnny Unitas at quarterback. He's got Raymond Berry at wide receiver. He's got Lenny Moore. I mean, he's got a terrific team. And in his second year, they got to the NFL championship game against Jim Brown and the Cleveland Browns. Well, this is the last Cleveland Browns championship. They not only beat the Colts that day, they beat them 27-0. Shula then does one of his really great coaching jobs ever the next year in 1965. No, they didn't win it. But they tied for first place with the Green Bay Packers. They had to have a one-game playoff of Green Bay. Can't remember if it was in Milwaukee or Green Bay, because Green Bay used to split. This may have actually been a county stadium. One of the two. It may have been at Lambeau. And during the season, Johnny Unitas got hurt. Now, I'll bet Dick from Milton knows what I'm talking about here. He's probably all over this. Johnny Unitas got hurt, and the backup was Gary Quazzo. And Gary Quazzo, for an NFL backup, was a very good backup quarterback in the NFL. Very good. Everybody knew it. And Quazzo gets hurt. Well, now he's out of quarterbacks. So Tom Matte had played some at Ohio State. Some. So Tom Matte, who's his running back, Shula installs him as the quarterback, because they need to have somebody. And they somehow get to this one-game playoff, which they lose in overtime to Green Bay. Which, ironically, Bart Starr got hurt in the game, and Zeke Bretkowski was playing. So it was the backup quarterback for the Packers against the running back for the Colts. And then, of course, there's the famous year where the Colts blow everybody out. In 1968, Johnny Unitas is hurt again, and Earl Morrill's the quarterback. And They go 13-1, and they run Cleveland out of Municipal Stadium for the championship. They are a 19-point favorite against the Jets. And, of course, as you all know, the Jets win the game 16-7. Morrow plays just a mediocre game at quarterback. Unitas comes in. Arm is dead at that point. I mean, he's playing hurt. And, you know, he drove the Colts to one touchdown. They kept threatening, but they couldn't get in, and the Jets won. Well, of course, the Colts come back and win Super Bowl V. Except Shula's not the coach anymore. He took the Dolphins' job. And I think it was Don McCafferty, I think, was the Colts coach that year. But Shula then shows what a really great coach he is. He takes over the Dolphins, who started the franchise in 66. Yeah, they've drafted Larry Zonk out of Syracuse. Yeah, they've drafted Jim Kick out of Wyoming. Yes, they drafted Bob Greasy out of Purdue. But in 1970, he takes a franchise that is just going nowhere. In his first year, they go 10-4, they make the playoffs. Then his second year there, they get to the AFC Championship game. They shut the Colts out, 21-0. They go to the Super Bowl, and in the Super Bowl, they get dominated by the Cowboys. So now, Shula has now coached in four gigantic games in his career. He has coached in, five gigantic games in his career. I got to give that one playoff game. Now, in those games, he's 1-4, but the playoff game at Green Bay with Tom Matte at quarterback, to me, is a brilliant coaching job. The other ones, that's in the biggest games. He's now lost two Super Bowls. He's lost an NFL championship game, and he's won an NFL championship game. In the NFL championship game, he lost the Super Bowl. So then they get to 72, and they go 17-0. Now, despite being the undefeated team, they were rotating which division would host the AFC Championship game at the time. That's why the Steelers hosted, because it was a rotation. Well, he calls one of the... He does two things in that game against the Steelers. One, they're losing. They are not playing well. Three Rivers is going crazy. They've got everything, you know. It's a miracle season. Everything's going great for the Steelers. And he calls a fake punt with Larry Seipel. Okay, now the fake punt wasn't at midfield. I think the fake punt was at like the 20-yard line. It's a big play. They got a first down. The Steelers never expected it. And Earl Morrill, who had taken over for Bob Greasy in the fourth game when Greasy broke his ankle, is now struggling. Not having a good game. So Shula makes the bold move. Here's the guy that's started and won all these games in a row for them. He pulls him for Bob Greasy, and Greasy then rallies the Dolphins. They get to the Super Bowl, and he makes the decision going into the Super Bowl, he's going to start Greasy. And they win 14-7 over the Redskins. And then the next year, they go 12-2. They dominate again, and between Mercury Morris, Larry Zonka, Jim Kick. They still have Paul Warfield. They got Greasy the whole time. And they dominate the Vikings, and they win that game 24-7. So they win back-to-back Super Bowls. So now the whole thing about Shula's inability to, quote, win the big one is now out the door. He's now won back-to-back Super Bowls. To let you know how progressive and a forward thinker Don Shula was, he was on the competition committee, and he was one of those who strongly, strongly urged the NFL to change their rules on passing the ball. The 5-yard rule on contact, pass interference, everything. Shula was a big backer of that. And remember, this guy has gone from, I've got unitis, so then I've got a running game, and then he made the Super Bowl with David Woodley as his quarterback. I mean, it's like going to give. I mean, Got to get some credit for that. And then he drafts Dan Marino, and guess what? He's not running the ball anymore. He's throwing the ball all over the lot. So Shula always adapted to the times and in the game. 347 career wins. And yeah, even when his record-setting game with Doug Peterson as a quarterback. So he passed away at the age of 90 today. He is one of the greats of all time. He had to make a very, very important decision very young in life. Shula was a devoutly religious man. And early in his life, he made the decision to not become a priest because he badly wanted to be a coach and he didn't think he could do both. And he ended up along the way with 16 grandchildren and 5 great-grandchildren, I believe, along the way. So, 90 years old. And when you talk about the great coaches in the history of pro football, his name must be mentioned on the list. You know, whether it's George Halas, Curly Lambeau, Bill Belichick, Bill Walsh. You know, you can go through the great ones of all time that, you know, would be on any given list. Chuck Knoll. Joe Gibbs. Joe Gibbs deserves to be on there. There aren't many guys that won 3 Super Bowls with 3 different starting quarterbacks. Joe Theismann, Mark Rippon, Doug Williams. So it would be a lot that would be on that list. But certainly, Don Shula is absolutely going to be always on that list. Today's show brought to you by Purdy Insurance, Market Street in Sunbury. Go to purdyinsurance.com. The governor is next. I know we're all in.
For nearly 100 years, Purdy Insurance has been your locally owned, family-operated source for insurance products. With a staff of over 20 and partnerships with some of the industry's most trusted companies, Purdy has the experience and resources to get the job done. Whether you need personal, home, and auto, or complex business insurance solutions, Purdy will help you navigate through the process. Call today at 570-286-5855, or better yet, stop in their Sunbury office to see what Purdy Insurance can do for you.
When it comes to car buying, there's the other guy's way, and then there's the SMC way. The other guys force you into a vehicle you really don't want. The Sunbury Motors way lets you take the time you need to browse, ask questions, and take the test drive and think on it. For over 100 years, the Mertz family and all their employees have made your experience the most pleasant one you'll ever have. The other guys won't offer you the best price for your trade, no matter how much they say they will. The SMC way is their promise to provide you with the most money the market shows your vehicle is worth. The SMC way is to offer you all applicable factory rebates on new vehicles and generous discounts. Looking for a pre-owned vehicle? The SMC way checks each vehicle in a 200-mile radius to determine the lowest price, then beat it. It's the lowest price promise, just part of the SMC way. The choice is up to you. The other guy's way or the SMC way? The SMC way wins every time. Sunbury Motors Company in the North 4th Street Auto Plaza, Sunbury, and at sunburymotors.com. Selling more cars and satisfying more customers for over 100 years.
Sports talk where your voice counts. This is the Steve Jones Show on News Radio 1070 WKOK. Now from the Sunbury Motor Studio, here's Steve Jones.
Today's show brought to you by Purdy Insurance, Market Street in Sunbury. Go to purdyinsurance.com. Purdy's have served this valley for decades, finding their customers the right insurance, auto, home, life, business, bundles, and doing everything they can to find the best price. And they update those policies, and if there's ever a claim, they go to work as if it happened to them. Customer service means everything to them at Purdy Insurance, Market Street in Sunbury. Go to purdyinsurance.com. We're in the Sunbury Motors studio, Sunbury Motors, 4th Street in Sunbury, Sunbury Motors Kia, Routes 11 and 15 in Hummel's Wharf. Go to sunburymotors.com. Check out their great line of Ford, Lincoln, Hyundai, Kia, pre-owned inventory. Check out what you like, and you can make the purchase online from the comfort of your own home at sunburymotors.com. Mike Gross in a few moments. First, our play-by-play call of the day, looking back at the late, great Don Shula. We hope and we think. All right. Well, with that, we'll bring in Mike Gross. Mike, welcome. It's great to have you with us. Welcome to the show.
Good to be with you, my man.
First of all, to you and yours, we hope everybody is safe and sound, and miss seeing you in person.
Yeah, I would echo that sentiment. I miss the whole Penn State gang a lot. I was just talking to Frank Bodani on the phone the other day, and we were saying exactly that. But I'm good. I'm fine. I'm been able to stay pretty busy, I'm in a family of people who can kind of live inside their own head anyway, so we're doing okay. I hope you are too.
Yeah, doing very well. Thanks for asking. Appreciate that. All right, so you talked about staying busy. One thing that Penn State has done, one item that Penn State does, is they've run out a series of the assistant coaches, and then James Franklin's going to be up again later this week. What do you think that has done to keep Penn State football out there? Because I know in talking to a couple of Michigan people, Michigan football has done zero.
Wow, really? That's surprising. Yeah. It's funny. I was talking to Greg Kincaid of the sports information staff. I was communicating with him about the stories I'm doing for the Town and Gown magazine. This is a while back now. This is before all this stuff. I mean, not before the pandemic, but and I said to him, I emailed to him, you know, has James thought about doing any kind of press conferences? It might be a good idea, just because everybody's looking for something to do right now. And a couple days later, I'm certainly not suggesting I had anything to do with it. It's a pure coincidence. But right after that, they started doing it with James and then Sandy Barber and then the whole gang. And I do think it's been good. I think the coaches have actually enjoyed it. And I remember James saying when he did his, and again, like you said, he's doing another one on Wednesday, but I remember him saying, you know, believe it or not, it's kind of good to see you guys see your faces. I can't believe I'm saying that, but it is, and it was. It was, and he was very good, and all the coaches have been very good. It strikes me that this is a very modern football coach kind of thing, to be able to do this technology and communicate in this way. It's kind of guys that are living in this new environment pretty effectively.
All right. When you look at this particular year, we don't know when people are going to be allowed to get back and going. No decisions have been made about seasons and so forth. But say there is a decision to start, quote, on time. Say that happens. The vast majority of, I think, I would not just the vast majority, I think everybody in the Big Ten didn't do anything in the spring. But in the South, some schools did. What kind of premium is this going to put on coaching and organization?
Well, I think it's even more than usual. I thought I saw where Nick Saban did an interview. I think it was yesterday, where he said he thinks that he always felt like after winter conditioning, after that roughly month of just conditioning, not doing football stuff, but conditioning, his team was always in the best shape of the year, right at the beginning of spring practice.
Right.
So he felt like if they could do that month of conditioning and then go into preseason camp, like let's say in the second week of July, you do a month of conditioning and then go into the normal schedule of preseason camp, they could play a season in that way. Now, you talk about how much does organization mean. I mean, it's hard to overstate it. I'm always amazed at all the balls that these guys keep in the air. It's even going to be more so now, and might even be more so with Penn State because to some extent they're learning a new offense. That might be part of it too. It's huge. It's huge. There's no way around it.
When you look at this team, what do you think the team potential is? I mean, we didn't get to see it, obviously, in April in a blue-white game or in any kind of scrimmage, but what kind of potential does this team have based on the people coming back?
Yeah, I think they have a lot of potential, especially offensively, to be, I think, a little better than they were last year, and they were pretty good last year. I think they had a better season than maybe the majority of us expected last year. I think a lot of us were thinking 9-3-ish, and then whatever happens in the bowl game. I think offensively they have a chance to be really good, and a lot of it comes down to Sean Clifford, and a lot of it comes down to, as always, offensive line, and is the offensive line going to reach its ceiling? Defense, very, very athletic. Maybe some more holes to fill. Obviously, well, no question, some more holes to fill on defense. But very, very athletic, and at the center of it is going to be, I think, Micah Parsons is going to be one of the best college football players in the country. Not just linebackers, not just defensive players. Period. So I think the potential's there to be pretty good.
What does it say about Parsons? Normally, Mike, as you know, when somebody makes a move on defense, it's closer to the line of scrimmage. Safety to linebacker to defensive end. This guy moved back. What does it tell us about him, not just as an athlete, but also the work ethic to make it happen?
Well, I think the work ethic kicked in after he got to college. I don't think that came perfectly naturally to him because he was so gifted. And I saw him play a couple times in high school. And honestly, I remember talking to some guys in the press box when they were playing Imhotep Charter at Harrisburg. I remember saying, he looks like a linebacker to me. I mean, there's no doubt that he can go backwards. There's no doubt that he can play in space. There's no doubt he can pass cover. I mean, it made perfect sense for him to make that move. But a lot of people make that move and don't figure it out. A lot of people who are used to going forward all the time, explode off the ball and go find the ball, it's a much different animal when you're going backwards and playing in space. So I guess he had to get to college and figure it out. And I think this last season, he just made gigantic strides as far as understanding how to do it and how to unleash that athleticism. And he really now is a sideline-to-sideline guy. And the way he played the Cotton Bowl, man, oh, man, I thought that was – I was blown away by that performance.
And the way he played the Cotton Bowl, we could say that about Journey Brown. What did you see, Mike, in the evolution of Journey Brown as a running back last season?
It's funny because that's one of the guys that I'm going to be writing about for Town and Gown. So I talked a lot to particularly to Jajuan Sider, their running backs coach, and they really, when they got him, they really did suspect that they were getting more of a track star than a football player. And it took a while for him to figure that part out. It's in some ways it parallels Parsons a little bit in the sense that he could do it in high school based so much on athleticism. I mean, he had a 700-yard game with 10 touchdowns in high school.
Yes,
that's pretty
yes,
good.
He did.
That's a pretty good number.
Yeah.
But I think the ultimate sort of manifestation of it was that touchdown run he had in the Cotton Bowl where he just dragged people and shrugged people off and made so many people miss and then really dragged the guy into the end zone. He's a guy who has figured it out. He just, in terms of his work habits, from everybody, according to everybody, he's just a grinder. He's just a guy who shows up every day and works at it and has it. They haven't seen like spectacular gains in strength or anything like that. They've seen steady day after day after day after day gains. And now, you know, you're talking about a guy who could be one of the best in the country at his position.
Obviously, we haven't seen the any changes or subtleties as to how different the Penn State offense could be structurally because, obviously, there was no spring practice. But when you look at Sean Clifford, what are a couple of areas where you feel Clifford has a chance to be really good, Mike, but what are a couple of areas he needs to improve to be really good?
One of them is throwing the deep ball, which I think he struggled with that, and he seemed to struggle with it in the same way over and over. He wasn't sort of putting it out there and trusting his receiver to go get it. It was a lot of times it was sort of like he's got to make the Willie Mays over the head catch kind of thing. There was a lot of that, and I think he's, but I think he is a good combination of drop back ability and the ability to run around and make plays with his feet. I think he's fine in that regard. Maybe a little bit better decision-making, maybe a little bit better ability to see what's available and see the primary thing that's available, not just see something that's available, but the best thing that's available. And that's just – it's just playing quarterback is hard. And also, I think he was probably hurt at the end of last year, the last month or so of the season. So I thought he did. I thought he did fine. But it is important for him to take the next step. If you look at the teams that are really in contention to win the national championship, look who they have at the quarterback position. I mean, it's studs. It's not pretty good guys. It's beasts. And he's got to take that step. That's great. If they're really going to be good, if they're going to be in that playoff hunt, he's got to take the next step.
Obviously, tight end has been one of those positions when people look at Penn State, they talk about linebacker, sometimes they talk about running backs. But you start with Ted Kwolek and start working through the great lineage of tight ends at Penn State. Yeah. They've had their fair share. When you look at Pat Freiermuth, what do you see in him?
Well, it's almost in terms of size and mobility, it's almost a Gronkowski kind of guy. I'm not saying he's going to be that good. And he probably has to be a better blocker because, you know, I mean, again, not to beat the Gronkowski comparison to that, but he was a great physical blocker in addition to the right. But red zone, over the middle, those skills that that previous tight ends like Gesicki was almost a glorified wide receiver. I think Freiermuth can do what Gesicki can do, but also be that big physical true tight end who's kind of part of the offensive line and part of the blocking schemes in addition. So, I mean, I don't know if he can be better than Kwolek. I mean, I don't know how to get Kyle Brady's another one. Who knows? But he's legitimate. He's an NFL player someday and a really good college player right now.
When you look at Penn State, is there an area in the football team that you say, if that area is just a little bit better, watch out, here they come?
I would say offensive line, and this is interesting because when Troutwine did his when he did his Zoom conference with us, I was sort of curious. I was surprised that Lime Grover got shown the door, and I didn't really understand why. I didn't see that coming. I mean, I'm not saying he was great or wasn't great or anything like that, but. I was surprised at that. So I asked Troutwine, you know, what's going to be different with you as the offensive line coach for the offensive linemen on the field? What's going to be different for them? And surprisingly to me, because a lot of times a guy would naturally kind of duck that question to in deference to the previous guy, he talked a lot about technique. And we're going to learn to use our legs, and we're going to put our hands back and use our legs in the run game, and we're going to be two-hand punch guys in the pass game. And he went on for a couple minutes just about technique things. So I don't know if this is something that fans are going to notice. I don't know if it's something that I'm going to notice. But maybe there's some method there in terms of the physical technique of playing offensive line that can get them to the next level. I don't know. I was kind of struck with his answer to that question.
You mentioned a couple times that you're writing to preview the season. What really is what did they say to you? What do they want from you to put this article together that we're looking forward to reading?
You mean the editors?
Yeah. What do they want from you?
Oh, okay. All right. Well, it's the thing with the Town and Gown thing, the Town and Gown magazine thing. We kind of do profiles of individuals. So I'm doing Journey Brown, and then a little bit on the running back group and their coach, and then I'm also doing. That's it. That's the one I'm doing. That's the one I'm doing for sure. Is the one of the running backs, and it really is just to do a little more in depth than you would normally do on a in a newspaper story. Get into their background a little bit, talk to their parents, talk to their high school coach maybe, and certainly talk to their position coach. And it's more like a preseason magazine type feature. But another thing that Town and Gown does that's kind of interesting is they give us this survey to fill out, like who's the what are the big storylines of the season? What's the who's going to be the best quarterback in the Big Ten? Who's going to be the best running back? Who's going to be the best defensive player? And then they ask for our predictions. So that's that sort of gets a consensus of the guys on the beat in terms of in terms of what we're predicting and what we're seeing for the season going and how everybody's assessing everything. That's a good barometer of that. Is that what you're asking?
I'm just asking just so that we know what to look forward to. That's all.
Yeah. So they do a really nice job with that magazine. It's really worth checking out. And all the familiar guys, not all of them, but most of the familiar guys on the beat are doing a couple stories, and it's really well done.
I think this is obviously an easy one here. How anxious are you just to have some semblance of normalcy again?
Oh man, I'm anxious. I'm very anxious. I mean, just to get back to the churn of every day. Just there being games and there being events I'm as busy as I've ever been, but it's all sitting in front of a computer and talking on the phone I miss going to games. I miss just the whole ritual of Penn State Saturdays. That's driving up there with my boy Dave Jones and the conversations there, you can imagine, and just the whole thing with the gang, and I miss it a lot. And it's coming. It's coming. We're gonna get back. We're gonna get back.
Well, you're doing really a fabulous job, and I appreciate the fact you came on, and it's the first time we've had you on, which is our mistake, and we hope to have you on
really
many more times.
That Steve. What are you thinking? I don't know. All right. I guess what you're doing. You're very experienced. I guess you know what you're doing.
No, we got to get you back on a lot more. I appreciate you very much.
Thanks, Steve. I enjoyed it, man. Be well.
Thanks, Mike. You too, Mike. Right. Mike Gross joining us. He does a great, great job covering Penn State football. One of the many outstanding beat writers. He mentioned, they get a consensus from everybody there as to what's going on. It's all the familiar names. Well, they're familiar names because they've done such a great job in their respective careers like Mike has. They've been able to stay on this Penn State football beat this entire time. All right, we'll come back. We'll more in a moment here on ESPN Radio, on News Radio 1070 WKOK. All right, so the big news is actually a week from today, from what I understand it, Matt. A week from today is May 11th.
That is correct.
And you know what that means.
We've actually altered it some. He will probably physically be here every once in a while after May 11th, but it's only on an as-needed basis for the other side of the building.
Oh, so he won't be in at all.
No, he actually told me he will be in. There's some times where he'll have to come in.
Payday? He's sitting in a wire. I hate that guy. I can't stand that guy. Oh. All right. Well. Is it bad I already filled out my election ballot? In fact, I filled out four. Is that bad? Just asking.
As far as I know, there's not a whole lot to vote for, no matter what party you're in.
I'm just playing along with the governor. Is Catrillo with two L's?
Believe it or not, that's not the first time I've been asked that question.
I'm just doing some write-ins here.
No, thank you.
Oh, no, this would be good for you. A little publicity. Oh, I got a whole month. I could fill out a whole bunch. All right. Today's show brought to you by Purdy Insurance. Market Street in Sunbury. Go to purdyinsurance.com. And we're in the Sunbury Motors studio. Go to sunburymotors.com. And you can buy online.
Taking your calls at 800-795-9565. This is the Steve Jones Show on News Radio 1070 WKOK. Now, from the Sunbury Motor Studio, here's Steve Jones.
Today's show brought to you by Purdy Insurance, Market Street in Sunbury. Go to purdyinsurance.com. And right now, phone and purdyinsurance.com, the way to get in touch with them. Look, you want the best in the business. You want to be working around people who are the best. Because you know that you end up being the best because you get their best. And when it comes to insurance, that's Purdy Insurance. Auto, home, life, business, maybe it's bundles. And they'll do everything they can to find you the best price whenever applicable. And if they'll update policies, they'll make sure you're covered the entire time. And if there's ever a claim, they will go to work as if it happened to them, because customer service means everything to them. That is Purdy Insurance, yes, at Market Street in Sunbury, but just remember, you can go to purdyinsurance.com. And we're in the Sunbury Motors studio. Sunbury Motors, yes, physically at 4th Street in Sunbury, and Sunbury Motors Kia, routes 11 and 15 in Hummel's Wharf, but online at sunburymotors.com. You can check out the complete line of Ford, Lincoln, Kia, Hyundai, their pre-owned inventory. You can, in the comfort of your own home, look through, find exactly the vehicle and the price range that fits you. And then, guess what? From the comfort of your own home, you can get that vehicle. It's all at Sunbury Motors. SunburyMotors.com. So I saw an article today in Bloomsburg Business Week. It's about burnout. Let's see. So Matt Cotrillo, do you suffer from exhaustion, energy depletion that leaves you struggling to engage even in basic tasks?
On most days, no.
Detachment, mental distancing from your job and cynicism about its importance?
No, especially not at this time.
Do you have any loss of productivity and satisfaction?
Not usually, no.
All right, get the suit on the phone, because I think these three apply. I don't have any energy. Says here, know the cause. Formulate an anti-burnout plan. Oh, here we go. Ooh, brain breaks. Pepper 5 to 20-minute sessions dedicated to activities that aren't work, household chores, or caregiving. It might be exercise, meditation, reading, or cooking. Do you do any of those?
I did a whole lot of grilling yesterday with the nice day we had here.
There we go. Spend 30 minutes or more on calming activities. These are longer versions of brain breaks. Now, when it comes to the suit, he does say that he thinks too much. I can attest to that. He does think too much. No, yeah, he thinks too much. You know, that brain is always, you know, it's going. And, of course, this is always one of my favorites. Repeat your mantras. Really? That gets you going? All right. Whatever makes it work for you. I'm like big into the self-motivation thing. This is not the moment to be perfect. Get it done. This is a challenging situation that's rooted in factors I can't control. Look, just get it done. Sit there and like, oh. Got to repeat my mantras. Really? Okay, good. Here, you keep repeating them. I'm going to go over here and work. All right. I'm not big on that stuff. Never have been. People say that to me, and I'll just sit there and go, okay, sure. Good luck with that. All right. So the Jordan documentary, of course, continues. It was at parts 5 and 6 last night. And again, this is a situation where only because through age and, you know, this is 25 years ago. Well, 25 years ago, I was doing this and everything, almost everything else I'm doing now. So I was always following it. I have learned nothing out of this so far. but I have found it extremely engaging and very, very entertaining. I think it's been really well done, and I think it's excellent. Doesn't mean I have to sit there and learn anything. I haven't learned anything from it. I already knew about all this stuff. Yeah. Dream Team. Monte Carlo. The gambling thing. There's nothing in it that's... Oh, there's some groundbreaking stuff in there. Well, it's not if you followed it. If you followed it, there's no groundbreaking stuff in it. If you know, the Bulls were a team you followed. With the Dream Team, look, the Dream Team is something. There's a lot made out of Isaiah Thomas not being on the team. Okay. But this is what the Dream Team was. Think about it. The Dream Team was actually a team that was put together. I mean, think about how they put it together. You had a power forward in Karl Malone. You had Jordan. Oh, you also had Clyde Drexler. You had Magic. You had John Stockton. You had Bird. You had Ewing and Robinson. You had Barkley. Think of it. Like, look at all the different positions I've talked about here. The different skill sets. All the different positions. I mean, the only one that doesn't really fit is Leitner because, I mean, look, they had a debate whether you're going to, you know, there was a debate ongoing as to how to do this. Were you going to do it with all pros? Were you going to do it with six pros, six college players? You know, they ended up settling on the one college player, and Leitner was the one college player who was the best, you know, the best college player at the time. But you knew darn well he didn't fit with this group. I mean, he didn't fit with them at all. You know, you had Scottie Pippen. I mean, look at all the different skill sets. That's one thing that is very underrated about the Dream Team was that the Dream Team was put together like a team. How would you like to have a team put together? And that's the part nobody's ever talked about. They've always thought, hey, look, there's Magic, there's Larry, there's MJ, there's Pippen, there's and Barkley and Ewing and on and on and on you go. You know, you have Stockton and Malone and Drexler. You know. But then you actually look at how the Dream Team was put together, and you can see that they were put together in such a way where it was actually, okay, what's the best kind of team you can have? Who fits the profile of the team we're putting together? Now, you're saying, I'll give you an example of what is not a team. And you can tell just by record. But the 2004 Olympic team that was put together, that played in Athens. In Athens, Cale Sanderson earned more gold medals than that entire team combined. And the reason was at that point, 12 years in, where the NBA thought they could throw 12 people out there and they were going to win it. And that was anything but a team. That was just a group of all-stars mishmashing together and playing. That's all it was. The Dream Team, what made the Dream Team special was, first of all, it was the first time this collection had ever been together, but it was also put together as a team. Okay. What will make us, quote, a better team? What positions do we need? What skill sets do we need? Now, they won the smallest margin of victory was, what, 32? And everybody bought into it. That was the other part. You know, having Chuck Daly as the head coach really helped. And they talked about the world-famous Monte Carlo pickup game between Jordan and Magic, where, I mean, this was not one of those, let's go out to the playground here, odds, evens. Oh, good, I'll take Matt Cotrillo first. Okay, great. And I'll take the suit. Okay, great. I'll take the chief. Okay, great. Right, this was, all right, okay, odds, evens, great. Okay, I'll take Scottie Pippen. Okay. And I'll take Larry Bird. Okay. I'll take Ewing. Okay. I'll take Drexler. Okay. Okay. Now that's a pickup game. And then the part about the gambling, about cutting off from the media for a couple of weeks, the pressure of it all. These are all things that, when they were happening, were big, big stories. The trip down to Atlantic City during the New York series, big story. I mean, if there's anything I would take out of that, that was, you know, they talked about the politics, you know, well, Harvey Gantt was running for the U.S. Senate against Jesse Helms in 1990. I remember the race completely. I want to say Gantt was, I don't think they said this, I think Gantt was the mayor of Charlotte, I think, at the time. And Jordan didn't endorse anybody. He made the offhand comment about, well, Republicans buy shoes too. And that didn't go over big. But this is something, and I've said this about Tiger Woods. I think it's important for people to be people in terms of what you are comfortable being. So I'll give you an example. LeBron James. LeBron James is comfortable commenting on social issues. He's comfortable, you know, he's comfortable talking about, I think it's safe to say he's comfortable talking about race relations. On the court, he's been brilliant. He has taken his money and he has given back. Look what he's done for schools in Akron. Oh my goodness. But he's comfortable doing that. And I respect that. Steve Kerr, Greg Popovich have both been outspoken about issues. Conversely, Tiger Woods has been criticized for not talking about issues. Does anybody know politically how Tiger Woods feels? Politically, does anybody know how Peyton Manning feels? Politically, does anybody know how Mike Trout feels? Does it matter to you what Mike Trout feels politically, or Peyton Manning, or Tiger Woods? Well, that was the same with Jordan. Jordan was like, I mean, Jordan voted and everything like that, but, you know, he wanted to be a businessman. He wanted to be a basketball player, and he wasn't, it wasn't comfortable. It wasn't his deal to be an activist. Now, he got criticized for it, but I don't understand why, you know, this is something I've never understood about certain people. When they get mad at you about not caring about what they care about. Okay, you really need to do this. And you stand there and say to them, okay, at any point in this conversation, did I ask you what I thought you thought? Was there any point in this conversation where I asked you about your opinion on me? I don't recall that. People need to be comfortable doing with it. LeBron James is very comfortable, and whether you agree with him or not, is very eloquent in what he says about situations. Steve Kerr is very comfortable and eloquent, and also has a past history based on his father's death in Beirut many, many years ago. And some people aren't comfortable talking about that. Tiger Woods isn't. Michael Jordan isn't. So I never, you know, you're going to criticize him. What? Because he doesn't want to do what you want to do? You know, people talk about your name, your platform, and so forth. You got a name, you have a platform. Well, you know what? There are ways of using your name and platform. You watched that documentary last night. Did you see all the young people, some in wheelchairs, that Jordan was taking the time to be with? The impact, the pictures, the signing, making them feel better. That's what I call an impact. Great, great piece on Golf Channel during the Masters. And I really apologize for not knowing, remembering the full story here. But the guy loved golf, and he loved Tiger Woods, loved Tiger Woods. But then he got sick. I want to say it was cancer, and he got sick. And so his family, I think they wrote a letter to Tiger Woods, you know, obviously to his representatives, wrote a letter to Woods, the whole thing. And they also were able to get him tickets because his lifelong goal was to go to the Masters and see Tiger Woods at the Masters. Well, they get him tickets to the Masters. And he's over at the practice range at Augusta National. And Woods is warming up. And then Woods is done. He puts his club in his bag, takes off the glove, signs the glove personally to him, and hands it to him. Now, who had an impact? Unfortunately, the man ended up passing away, but it lives with his family forever. Jack Nicklaus on that Sunday at Augusta when he won in 86 wearing the yellow shirt. Why did Jack wear a yellow shirt on that Sunday? Because early in his career, he befriended a young man named Craig Smith. I think it was Craig Smith, who's since unfortunately passed away. And he'd wear the yellow shirt on Sunday to tell, hey, Craig, you're with me. And he had said to Barbara Nicklaus, I guess the day of the tournament, he said, you know, I haven't worn a yellow shirt for Craig in a long time. Now, Craig had passed away at this point, but the mom was still alive. And then he ended up winning. It's like, it's just like, those are little things that are big things to people. So you can make an impact in different ways without getting out there and being an activist. And you can also accomplish a lot of things by being an activist. There's nothing wrong with either one. It's whatever fits your personality. I've never understood why people have been criticized for being an activist, and I've never understood people who are criticized for not being an activist. It's whatever you're comfortable with. That's just me. We'll come back with more in a moment here on News Radio 1070 WKOK, brought to you by our good friends at Purdy Insurance. Even in his home office space, when we play this, the suit still moonwalks, just in the privacy of his own home. A week from today, he'll be back on a limited basis. Did you know that? I think you knew that, Matt.
I did. He told me straight up during our weekly meeting.
I was up. I was looking through the ballot here for Ward 4. It's two L's, right?
Yes, but I will respectfully decline.
See, I'm just trying to, you know, take the governor's advice here. Kind of show everybody how it's done. I wrote you in for 8 offices.
Well, thank you.
None of them affect me in any way.
Of course they don't.
Today's show brought to you by Purdy Insurance. Market Street in Sunbury, go to purdyinsurance.com. And don't forget to go to sunburymotors.com.